Okay, hello everyone, and welcome.
Okay, thank you, Natalia. Okay, I'll take over. Hi everyone, thank you for joining us tonight. My name is H.C. Huen. I am the operations coordinator here at the Elizabeth Foundation for the Arts. My pronouns are they, them, and I would like to welcome everyone for joining us tonight at the virtual opening reception of Body to Body, the new member exhibition 2021, welcoming in our new member studio artists. To go over the guidelines tonight, Derek, can you move over to the next slide? So at the end of tonight's programming, there will be a short Q&A open comments portion. So just wait for all your questions, unless they're so urgent, you can leave them in the chat and we'll address them at the end. And just feel free to use the chat if you have questions, to make comments, or just want to give a little shout out, give some love to the artists. You know, be respectful of everyone. EFA is an inclusive and affirming environment. We are anti-oppression in all forms and no hate will be tolerated. And we would also like to make a land acknowledgement. We would like to honor, acknowledge, and affirm the Lenni Lenape Indigenous community who are still present, and to their ancestors for allowing us to hold space together in the greater New York City area. And there is also closed captioning available in tonight's event, and you can enable it down in the bottom by clicking on the live transcription. And then Derek, can you move on to the next section, please? And so a little more information about our organization, the Elizabeth Foundation. We are a 501c3 public charity dedicated to providing artists across all disciplines with space, tools, and a cooperative forum for the development of individual practice. We are a catalyst for cultural growth, stimulating new interactions between artists, creative communities, and the public. And we have three major programs, EFA Studio Program, EFA Project Space, and EFA Black Robert Blackburn Printmaking Workshop. And to find more information about our programming, you can visit our website, www.efanyc.org. And then I'm gonna hand this over to my colleague, Natalia Nakazawa, who is also the co-curator of this exhibition.
Hi everyone, my name is Natalia Nakazawa. I am the assistant director for the Elizabeth Foundation for the Arts studio program. And I've been working with EFA for a little bit over 9 years, which is a crazy amount of time. It keeps going by. And we're so lucky to have these incredible nine new members. The Elizabeth Foundation for the Arts Studio Program was founded in 1998. And our building itself is really filled with tons of studios. So we have 90 studios in the building. It's an incredibly rich program, and we have some of the most talented, incredible artists I've ever met in our building, which is just an incredibly rich community. So this is our group of nine new members. There is an open call that happens every fall. So if you're interested in applying to our open call, it is free to apply, and it's a fairly straightforward, streamlined, I think, very accessible application, which opens October 1st. And remains open until the end of November. So it will be coming up very soon. Get your application materials ready. It's fairly competitive. We have a group of usually we have between 200 to 250 applications that we receive with usually a very small number of slots available, ranging from like 8 to 11 slots at any given time. So we have an incredibly talented group of panelists that do the selection. So I also just want to extend my gratitude to the incredible arts professionals who joined us for a very intensive day of reviewing applications. So this cohort of new studio member artists were selected by a jury panel from a competitive pool of applicants. We want to thank our distinguished panel of arts professionals, Solana Chetman, Kayla Coleman, Ilaria Conti, Laurel Patak, and Seth Rodney, all of whom are incredibly well-respected arts professionals. So thank you to them and their insight in selecting the nine new members who we will be meeting today in just a minute. And so I just want to say thank you to everybody for being here. And we're going to be doing sort of a Pecha Kucha style presentations. So, they're going to be short presentations. Unfortunately, we don't have, 6 hours that we can be doing this, but we will be doing short presentations. I'll do an intro, or HC will introduce one of the artists at a time. And then we'll have about 10 minutes to hear from each of our artists. So I'm very much looking forward to this. HC, is there anything else that we want to cover before? Because actually we could get started a little bit earlier.
I think we can get started on the walkthrough.
Okay, let's do it. That sounds great. Fantastic. So here we have, again, unfortunately, we're opening today. Today is the first day of the exhibition. We unfortunately, because of COVID, we did not have a formal in-person opening, but we will be doing some upcoming events that are a little bit more tailored and sort of with the amount of people controlled. So, but you are all right now, if you want to come and see the exhibition, you can go online, you can register and come and see the exhibition in person. So in lieu of actually being in person, we're going to be just sort of walking you through the exhibition as it is in space. So go to the next. Perfect. So the first artist that we encounter as you move into the space is Melissa Joseph's work. We have several of her textile pieces that you can see on the right. Here we go. And Melissa's work often dives into archives, family archives, textiles and fiber, found objects, and creating these sort of narratives from memory. And I just think that they're so beautiful, tactile, and again, when you're standing in front of them, they have this sensibility to them that is both kind of fragile, but also robust and fun and somehow, bursting with life. So I really appreciate her work. Let's go to the next image so you can get some close-ups of this work.
So following up Melissa Joseph's work in the exhibition is Janet Lauren Hill's work. With Janet's work, she's interested and flipping the traditional gender roles of portraiture, and she often uses her partner as her generative muse. And she's exploring, the imagination and kind of playing with casting him and revealing in lurid roles inspired by internet wormhole catalysts and characters encountered during routine life. So the work presented here is part of her Back of Your Head series, where she's playing with the idea of the gaze of the object, where her work kind of plays, blurs the line between the sense of self, the constructed identity in relations to her partner. I'm asking, what are the risks of desire being rooted in speculation projection? And, I really enjoy her work where there is a level of playfulness with craft and materiality.
Great, let's keep moving. Okay, and we have Michael Mandenberg's work. Also, we realized that at some point, So many people, again, because of the pandemic, or it's just sort of in our psyche right now, turning towards their partners, turning towards their family members as the place to sort of make artwork or to sort of the creative crux of a lot of people's work. So Michael Mandenberg's work is no different. This is a painting of their partner, sort of at a moment, an intimate moment, you know, on FaceTime, and taking, you know, slowing that time down and actually being able to make an oil painting based on this very temporal moment, intimate moment between the two of them.
Following Michael's work is A Young Muse, as well as a collaboration with Nicholas Oz. This installation, Blood Memory, in Yu's work, she often explores Korean folk traditions and spiritual practices. Her work aims to transgress older traditions, regenerating them within queer and diasporic contexts. This installation consists of a bus, which is actually a vessel, an actual urn with both her and her mother's face on it, with a video and a ceramic knife with tassels. And the installation explores this morbid expectations of the performance of being female in the Korean culture and the persisting spiritual trauma of past generations.
And next we have work by Keren and Anavy. And Keren, actually, this is a site-specific installation, which was, you know, worked on for several weeks. So thank you so much, Keren, for all of your work on this. And I just love this work. It's really, I wasn't able to actually see it before I left in person, but now I can see it's incredibly immersive. HC, I don't know if you want to speak a little bit more about this piece, because I wasn't able to see it.
Yeah, so with Keren's work here, she kind of plays with this like artificiality of like architecture and artificial like structures within like a natural space. So she does play a lot with light as an element to create kind of drawings through shadow and creating these lines and color in the space. And there's actually, it's not as clear for you to see, but there is a projection of a circular video on the bottom on the floor of water flowing. And so she does play a lot with this juxtaposition of like architecture, nature, artificial, and like, you know, what is natural.
Fantastic. And this is the work of JC Lenahan, which is part of a larger series of work exploring the fist and protest. Across several large scale paper pieces and blackboard pieces. I believe this one is this one on paper, JC? I believe this one's on paper. But a lot of them, they're varying in scale and size. And I think that the interaction, again, this momentous kind of building up of images of the fist, it's creating this landscape, this new landscape of protest, of action, of how we sort of sense. And I just love this, like, you know, accumulatory, it's sort of this accumulation of fists over time has created this new landscape, which is just very powerful, and also speaks to its temporal qualities with the blackboard being changing. Potential to change. So thank you so much for this work. Let's go to the next. This is Mahsa.
So actually, yes, Mahsa Biglow, and the her work is actually installed in our conference room. And this is actually a video installation where there is a video casted within this cloth covered in concrete. And with Mahsa's work, it's based on the investigation of the intersection of art, mass media, technology, and post-colonialism. And she explores these themes in video installation performance through storytelling, oral history, and found footage.
Fantastic. And this is the work of Hayoon Lee. And Hayoon has brought together all kinds of materials and substances exploring rice in all of its capacities, rice in imagination, and also bones, human hair, into this sort of like cabinet of curiosities illuminated by this backlight.
Last but not least in the exhibition is Kosuke Kawahara, and he explores like meditative moments of instability and ways to confront fear through his practice. His approach is rooted in the volatile nature of the artist's experience, specifically his experience in Japan, where it's related to multiple major earthquakes and cultivating an understanding of the coexistence with nature. And with his work, he explores the acceptance of improvidence, imperfection, and insufficiency in process. And he's very interested in kind of exploring and addressing factors of material aging, deterioration, and discoloration. And the series of drawings presented in this exhibition, it's based off of his process, which is mostly improvised, that compounds textures and images. And he's interested in the ambiguity and the imagery, which is based on his curiosity with malformed organisms, meditative moments of instability, and the confrontation of fear.
Excellent. And I think with that, is Kosuke's work the last one?
Yes.
Okay, great. And with that, just so, because we're going to keep the flow of time going on, I just want to make sure to introduce the wonderful Melissa Joseph. So if you could, yes, great. And let's have Melissa. Beautiful, wonderful. Okay, so Melissa Joseph is one of my favorite people in the world, and I'm so happy to have Melissa. Melissa Joseph is interested in connecting people through collective memory and shared experiences. Her work addresses themes of diaspora, family histories, and the politics of how we occupy spaces. Joseph's practice involves the use of natural materials, mostly wool, felt, and textile. Through the use of felt, she fuses the image and the object into one. The fuzzy nature of the mediums reflect on the slippages of the content of memory. Welcome, Melissa.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm gonna put on my little timer to keep us on track. Thank you for being here and for inviting me to be here. My name is Melissa Joseph. I'm one of the new members, as Natalia Nietzsche introduced earlier. I was really happy to see the walkthrough of the show, though, because I haven't been in the space yet. So it was really nice to get to see the work of my co-new members. So I enjoyed that very much. I thought for this, I would just share, some conversation about the work I'm making now and making in general, and actually take the chance to show it by holding it in my hand, because I work with textiles and so much of it is about emotion. The feeling and the actual touching of the objects is so important. And it's funny when you see them on a wall, they can still communicate, I hope, but there is a whole other part to them that kind of is removed when you see them just as a photo, or if you see them, just separated from you with a invisible wall. So I thought this might be a nice way to kind of show these pieces that I make living and moving and being actually felt. So I started felting. I have a history of being a textile designer. When I was younger, I studied surface design, and worked in the design industry a little bit. So it became part of my natural vocabulary as an artist pretty early on. But I do find it to be a really important place to be working as a female identifying artist in a the labor that is involved in a lot of textile work is often, you know, falls on women. And I think it's not a coincidence that that's material that was available to me even as a young person, that I had access to that. So I am happy there working in that space. I feel like it's a natural place for me to be working. And I think I'm able to use it to communicate the things that I want to say as an artist, you know, very fluidly with that material. So I started felting during COVID, during the pandemic. I kind of discovered the process through some YouTube tutorials. and it sort of opened these floodgates that I can't, you know, that are never closing. So after a year of just experimenting and making and experimenting and making, I kind of discovered this way that the images and the objects can become one thing. And for me, that's really important because I, you know, there's this idea of things having emotional meaning or carrying weight and history with them through either, you know, past people who have interacted with them or just the earth. You know, I pick up things like rocks and I like old rusted metal things that are dug up from the ground. And so this connection to something, some historical line, whether it's one that I'm familiar with or one that I'm just jumping in the middle of, you know, I do feel attached to that sort of lineage. So the felting started last year. I slowly became able to work with wet felting, and then I discovered needle felting, which gave me a little more control over image, because when you use wet felting, there's a distortion that happens that I had less control over, which also lends itself to this idea of memory and thinking about things in time and moving through time and how we access and change the things that we refer to as sometimes as needed, and then sometimes just as neural pathways allow. So the softness and the distortion is welcome sometimes, but there is a specificity sometimes that I also want to capture. So the combination of the two processes really allows me to kind of work with that. And then some of my newer work, a newer body of work that sort of developed through the spring after, you know, I got vaccinated, there was some talk of possible herd immunity. It's now gone, but it was there for a minute. And it allowed for some hope to bloom. So in that time, I was thinking about things I was going to do, like traveling. And, you know, it hasn't happened yet, but I hope someday, in the not too far future, I will get to. And something came up, some old photos from my archive of airplane windows. So you can see one behind me printed on silk, actually two, and then some felted interpretations that I've kind of been working with, because this symbol of an airplane window feels to me like it offers a lot of things. I mean, airplane rides are not only happy. I certainly understand the heaviness of some forced or unwanted rides. So, you know, there is that part of it, but there is some sort of anticipation or transportation portal that they can offer that was a fertile ground for me to be exploring. And then in my research, I found out that when they were when commercial planes were early on being designed, they would have square windows that then allowed weak pressure points and caused planes to crash ultimately, which is why we have these windows now with no corners, because the pressure, they can withstand pressure from all of the sides. So now that form of this sort of oblong oval for me symbolizes something really, you know, sort of strong and able to resist pressure. And so I've been sort of working with that and kind of abstracting that into different materials. This is ceramic with felt inside. And here is like sort of another kind of interpretation of, you know, thinking about these shapes and the opacity that they can offer, or maybe something a little bit more hopeful, but also ambiguous. And so, so as my time is wrapping up here, I just again want to thank everyone for being here. And of course I'm open for questions. We're having an open studio in October. So hopefully anybody who wants can come through and visit us there. And yeah, it's just, that was just a little bit of a, an insight into where I was, where I am and I just want, that's all I have. So thanks for listening.
Thank you so much, Melissa. And I just wanted to pop in here really quickly and just say that I love like the sort of embodied images, and they feel really lived in because it's like you're literally physically manipulating the materials, and it feels, yeah, they're images that feel lived in. I think that's the easiest way I could put it. But thank you so much. HC is going to introduce the next person. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Melissa. And up next, we have Janet Lauren Hill. I really like Janet's work because just the level of playfulness and just like this work that's included in this exhibition is just, you know, part of her series, The Back of Your Head, which is of her partners. Like, how often do we stare at the back of our partner's heads and like really have admiration for it? And just kind of this level of like beginner's mind and appreciation and just playfulness. And I do appreciate the materiality in her work, where she does revert back to a lot of things that do remind us of like being back in elementary school, such as like glitter, you know, pipe cleaners, and like the game of parachute. So I'm going to hand this over to Janet for her to present more on her work.
Hi, everyone. Hello, hello. Thanks for taking the time. And Melissa, thank you so much for bringing us to a more embodied place in the portal of Zoom. I just want to hear you talk more about your work, but here we are. And I'm going to share briefly two different series. So the first one I'm going to talk about comes from an experience I had where, as a teenager, I went and saw a Picasso retrospective, as there are many and many and many. And for whatever reason, the curators decided to partially curate that show around his muses. So you would enter a room full of the portraits of one woman in his life, and then the next woman would receive another room in his retrospective. And one room in particular was dedicated to Dora Maar, who he refers to as his weeping woman. So she's shown as this crying woman motif. And there's this horrendous quote from Picasso that talks about women as suffering machines and Dora as this sort of pure symbol of that for him. But Dora Maar was an incredibly talented artist in her own right. She was deeply immersed in the surrealist crew. And she mostly did photography, but also painted as well. And she refers to Picasso's portraits as lies and said, none of them are of me, of Dora Maar. They're all Picasso's. So this Back of Head series is really interested in how women's images have been used historically by mostly male artists as these motifs to project their fantasies, their sort of creative impetus upon, and they're just a scaffold to which they can place much more about themselves than anything about the person that they're representing. So I'm interested in using the back of my partner Jordan's head in that same way to show the absurdity of it, right? When it gets flipped, when it gets subverted, we start to realize how harmful and odd it is that we see this in so many ways. So here he's shown in that sort of romantic trope of the woman, the maiden, who's sort of tumbled down a hill and gotten flowers caught in her hair. Or you might see this in all the sculptures that are around New York, where you see women as victory or truth or wisdom, and next to a historically named man who's represented in all of his individuality. Just check, make sure I'm good here. So I'm playing partially with art history, but also media culture and critiquing that as well. So for me, seeing those cover after cover of romance novel with Fabio on the top of it, I started to wonder in my later years, does Fabio kind of represent this interesting gender slippage for maybe these housewives who were within a heteronormative structure, but kind of wandering further, right? He's got this long billowing hair, and I always wonder about that. Or anything that I kind of get trapped into, those sort of 2 a.m. YouTube wormholes where it's just video after video, like those 60s Batman, Batgirl TV shows with Yvonne Craig. Jordan gets cast in all of them, in all of the sort of luscious and luridness of it. And these are all stuffed portraits. So in some ways they sort of feel like maybe it's his head resting on a pillow at night. It sort of complicates that idea about fantasy. How much of these fantasies are constructed by one individual, or are they more culturally constructed? And is our buying in bringing along all the harmful baggage that they sometimes and frequently do come along with? Sometimes they're based off of real people. So at one point we were living above Dan from apartment one, who we only knew of from his weekly Soylent packages, which is this very odd meal replacement liquid. And this is sort of my extrapolation of what he might look like in all his sort of bro grammar awesomeness, but maybe he's losing a foot due to some nutritional needs. And that sort of wandering as sort of accessories to the portraits are key. It's important that you have to sort of navigate the portrait, right? You're not just sort of passively engaging with it. You're in some way having to be a body in space. In whatever kind of world building is starting to extrapolate from these portraits. Thinking a lot about sort of leaf peeping language in this piece. In New England, where I was for a long time, there's all this very sexualized language around peeping on leaves in the fall, and are you gonna catch the peak of it? Has it passed? This language has now since gained other associations, but this piece was really trying to think of that and also jumping into a big pile of leaves. I'm also interested in pulling it back into art history. So for me, one of my beloved paintings is of Ophelia by Rossetti. She's sort of laying up in the water, but that painting is showing her death, and people who drown do not drown like that. They don't look like they're just having a casual float in the river. Instead, they drown face forward because their arms get waterlogged and carry them forward into the water. So here Jordan's turned over, and we also see these little flies piecing up the fabric, bringing the true sort of grotesque of how women are consumed in true crime, in the sort of CSI, in the images we see all the time, but also in the muse for that painting, Elizabeth Siddell, who did die from pneumonia after sitting in the bathtub, sitting for that portrait too long. So sharing this quote for you all, just from Mary Kelly, Desiring Images, Imaging Desire, I'm really trying to think about complicating the gaze, my own gaze, implicating myself in some of these intoxication of sort of small boxes of desire and sexuality that we all are implicated in. With the pandemic, I started making parachutes. I was thinking about our participation in teamwork and how we think about teamwork as purely positive, like let's all get together, you know, many hands make light work. But I also see teamwork in this time as upholding oppressive systems. It's the things that we participate in and don't look at critically. So how have people grouped together around some of these deeply grotesque narratives that harm us and others? So here are a couple of those parachutes. These are 6 feet by 6 feet. That's size for its pandemic reasons. And Jordan and I started activating these parachutes together at first, just us.
Is that your circle? 6 feet enough to see your radiating influence?
6 feet enough distance to see the whole.
6 feet to see your possibility?
6 feet to see your harm.
So brief clip of a longer video, but you can see there some of those fists being activated as they rise and fall. And then I'll just end with this video of the most recent parachute, which is much larger. And from my recent residency down in Charlotte, North Carolina, where we were able to work with the community and have it activated by them.
How long can our misdirection keep them adrift with anxiety? And then it stopped, and we saw our shadows run under anything nearby.
Take a moment to look at the shadows past. Do you see the one before you? The one before that? Rush back outside, back to a safe distraction.
Let's turn this up once more, up and down.
Directions called out for someone else's feet. Fed them with all caps.
See them boil. A volcano built of collective shadow.
Erupting, exhausted eyeballs turned to look at one another.
Do we collect them up? How good are you at following directions?
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jana. Thank you. Okay, and thank you so much for that. And also, I love the eyeballs. Those are really, I was like, oh, that's fun. Okay, so we will be hearing from Ai Young Yu and Nicholas Oh. Through performance-based film, Ai Young Yu explores Korean folk traditions and spiritual practices. Her work aims to transgress older traditions, regenerating them with queer diaspora contexts. Blood Memory includes a bust of both Yu's and her mother's face in form of an urn, a video and ceramic knives with tassels. The installation explores the morbid expectations of the performance of being female in the Korean culture and the persisting spiritual trauma of past generations.
Hi. So we are a collaborative duo working primarily in performance-based film and site-specific installation. So we are currently working on an expansive project called Blood Memory. Blood Memory is the cultural tradition of recalling memories of your ancestors through ritual that we reimagine through various performances and spaces. And so we wanted to show a couple of clips of what we have been working on in the past 2 years.
So the first clip we're going to share, we filmed in Gyeongju. It's a 1,000-year-old city in Korea. It has lots of historical sites. I also grew up there, so I used to play around and see all these temples and stuff. When we started shooting together, we thought it'd be a great idea to kind of shoot there because it's such a historical context. We also got to work with a potter there. My background's in ceramics. So it was really nice to kind of talk to the local potter and use the local clay and see their ceramic process. And since I'm so interested in ceramics, we thought that would be great to use the ceramic process as a performance. So here is our video.
Next video that we're going to show was filmed at the Korean DMZ, so the demilitarized zone bordering North Korea and South Korea. And we shot specifically at the water bunker, which was a site of mass execution during the Korean War, and a frozen river which connects North Korea and South Korea.
And the next video is the one we shot upstate in the Catskills. This is one of the first videos that we shot. It's a compilation of, month and a half of work. it was really examining what it means to perform reimagined traditional rituals in American landscape as Korean Americans living in America. So a lot of the performances, there's a lot of trial and error, we're trying to figure out, you know, what works and what doesn't. So there is some overlapping images of what we tried in this series and then expanded into Korea, or we're also planning to go to Hawaii. So we'll try to re-perform some of these performances that really worked well and try to do it again. So here is compilation.
One last video, and so this was filmed in an abandoned farm colony in Staten Island, and this is a collaboration piece with artist Antonius Bowie, and it is sort of like exploring more dance as ritual.
Thank you so much. I also your collaborative website in the chat as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Ayoung and Nicholas, for like this beautiful presentation. Like, I really appreciate your work, especially kind of recontextualizing, you know, tradition and like kind of spiritual culture in a more contemporary diaspora, especially for Asians, and just kind of like kind of redefining what this means for, you know, for us. And so it's kind of like, you know, bringing this curiosity and kind of understanding more like what these things kind of translate to now and like how we live with it. So I really appreciate that. And so moving on to the next artist in the exhibition is Keren and Anavy. Keren is a multimedia artist who explores the dynamic relationships between nature, culture, and sites. Her paintings are the point of departure for large-scale site-specific installations and performances that operate on architectural scale. And so the installation that is currently presented in this exhibition includes a circular video projection of water, color window vinyl, and large tubes of plexi that have ink and color pencil paintings infused inside, both light and the motif of water are used, and the work reflects on the constant state of flux of bodies flowing through a passage towards their next destination. So Keren, you're welcome to present.
Hi, I'm happy to be here. Thank you so much for the EFA and for the curators of the show, Natalia and HC. And I would like to start with the... this presentation. Just a second, okay. So through the exhibition of the EFA, the current exhibition at the EFA that I did a site-specific installation for a small space in the office space, which is our group exhibition now. It's actually quoting a larger exhibition that I did and was closing just last week, that called I Wish I Had a River, and it was exhibiting at the Times Square inside of a gallery lobby space named Zaz 10 Times Square, and it was indoors and also outdoors on the billboards, as you can see. So actually the installation at the EFA is quoting parts of the larger exhibition that runs for 4 months at the Times Square. And inside those plexi tubes that you can see also in the EFA exhibition, there is painting, rolled paintings, ink and color pencils on Mylar. And I'm a painter, but I'm also a site-specific installation artist, and most of my installations based on my painting, I use them as a sculptural element eventually in the installation and sometimes in the performance. I'm also collaborating with the dance, with the dancers and with the dance. And recently I started to, when I say recently, I mean the past a year ago, I started also to introduce into my installation movement through video animations that also based on the paintings. The paintings are usually not, I don't use the painting as a sketches or as a draft. They are really large scale paintings that only after I finished them, I started to think about the process, how to relate them to a space, to a place that has a meaning. And the exhibition in the Times Square and also at the EFA, it has a connection to the city because New York was built on the water channels, and it's actually part of a very deep research I'm doing about water channels in the city of Manhattan, of the Bronx, of the Harlem River. And when I was invited to do the exhibition in Times Square, it was simultaneously when I got the studio at the EFA, and it was really the same district. And I was in the middle of a research about the Bryant Park, which is right across the gallery. And the Bryant Park, for example, used to be a reservoir. A reservoir is something that it's actually artificial source of water. So I'm in my exhibition and in my installation, I usually mix between artificial element like the plexiglass that you can see here, the plexi tubes, and also in this case, the plexi box, this called waterstone, for example, and a painting that is much more intuitive and meditative, like in this case and in the other cases, which is ink on Mylar. I use Mylar instead of paper in order to use the light also as a medium. And in this projection, actually it's the same projection that you can see in our group exhibition at the EFA, but at the EFA it's projected on the floor, and in the Times Square, as you can see here, it was projected on the billboards, and it's based on a very small painting that I did when I been in 2019 in a residency at Wasaac Project. And I did a series of painting based on the waterways in upstate New York. I didn't know I was going to create a video art from them. Eventually it becomes to be this video art, and you are inviting to see it. This is another part of the video. And it was an interesting question during this show about public art, which is something that I'm also have a great interest. Is a public art effect or doesn't affect about on the public, how much is the awareness of the passerby in the street and the connection between the art and the street, and of course about the nature and the urban city, which is something that are really interesting in more and more research, and to find out this connection between a place that has a history, a place that has a lots of going on. Four months ago, it was still during a very heavy COVID time. So you can see that the streets are a little bit empty, but this is a real question. How do people react to public art, if they react at all? And what is the relationship between a nature, a culture, which is culture, it's the city for me, and the viewers. This is the lobby space, and you can see the river that I created on the ceiling, which actually function as a river, but also as a floating sky. So it's something in between. It's a 20 yards, one piece ink painting on Mylar, again, playing with the light. And this is the garden. Garden is a theme that I am dealing with for the past 6 years. I did my first solo exhibition was in Wave Hill, which is a public garden that acts like botanical garden. So in this installation in the lobby, I created like garden that is something in between an underground water garden and I call this painting jellyfish. And something like a garden, because something with the lobby spaces and the buildings in Times Square, in the Midtown, in New York in general, it has a feeling of underground water for me. It's very disconnected from the environment outside. And this exhibition in the lobby and also at the EFA gave me the thoughts of thinking about the connection between the outdoor, the outside world and the inside world, especially during this pandemic. And this is one of my main source of inspiration for the orange color that you saw. We can see it everywhere in New York and in the city. And I found this orange and like this, very, very interesting, this fluorescent orange that got inside my painting together with the water and created this kind of tubes that artificial tubes that runs water from place to place. This is also an inspiration from the nature. As you can see that I did a laser paper cutout that used to be white. I sprayed them with this orange fluorescent. And also in the exhibition, I Wish I Had a River, it was a homage for the building. This is the original elevator doors that still exist in the building. It was a textile building from 1930. And I kind of, painted the pattern of the elevator doors in order to pay some kind of homage for the history. So I think let's see how I'm with the time. I work a lot with water, as you can understand, about water and with water. This is a tank filled with water and blue ink. And during the time of the exhibition, the ink started to grow a little bit on top of my painting and create a new layer on the painting. And I started to use around 3 years ago with this fish tanks with ink because it's created a life of their own, the material starting to have life of their own after my what I'm doing in the studio. So it's also kind of connected to nature for me, but at the same time connected to control. How can we control art? How can we control materials And I think it's something that the practice, I'm always trying to connect between the practice. This is my time. And I'm also trying to connect between my practice and the message that I want to send to the viewer. So I'm just going past, this is Wave Hill very, very quickly. Influence from the nature. And this is the dance performance based on the paintings. And it's important for me to say just the last sentence, that the concept of this is in pioneer works, for example, the concept of the choreography and the dance is based on the concept of the painting, in this case, Babylon Garden, and it's not a set for the performance. I mean, it really goes together. So thank you so much. And I really invite you to see our show. And I want to thank again to the curators, to the EFA, and to the wonderful artists that participate in this panel.
Thank you so much, Keren.
Thanks.
Just unshare your screen too. Perfect. Wonderful, thank you so much. Okay, we will be hearing from JC Lenahan. JC Lenahan's work functions as a series of questions regarding the acquisition of knowledge in terms of how information is distributed, disseminated, and discarded through the process of deconstructing objects and decirculating, decoding institutional relics. Thank you so much, JC.
Thank you, Natalia. I'll just say that I'm interested in epistemology, right? I'm interested in questioning this idea of knowledge and where we acquire our knowledge and what constitutes knowledge. During this pandemic, I was, of course, I was with my two girls, but I was reading, I'm a father of two, a 10-year-old and a 6-year-old, but I read all of Malcolm Gladwell's work, and then a friend of mine recommended that I read A Field Guide to Getting Lost, which is really what I want to talk about, because it talks about memory, it talks about uncertainty, it talks about loss, it talks about place, it talks about desire. So I think our gift as visual thinkers is our ability to question. Right. So I get asked all the time do I question everything? And my response is no, just the things that are important. But the book was a perfect segue from everything else I was reading. And there's one particular part of the book where she talks about collaborating with chance. So I started questioning this idea of collaborating with chance, because I find it to be such a poignant way to look. And she really referred to visual artists as, those that really, really collaborate with chance. So in saying that, I'll share my screen if I can share it. So I wanted to share, can everyone see this?
No.
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 That's no. What I was afraid
of. No. So hold on a second. Here we go. How about this? Can you see this?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. So I started thinking about land. I started thinking about territory. I started thinking about loss. And I, my work is started in the beginning about questioning about race and my own memory about race. And in particularly, my grandfather, who I never met, who was Chickasaw Indian, and also this idea of whiteness, right? So, of course we were experiencing this pandemic, but I was also thinking about the pandemic of racism and how when I was turning on, when and if, I'm not a big TV watcher, but when I would turn on the TV and I would see these protests, I would think about these new landscapes, and how it was such a ubiquitous, you know, happening. You know, it wasn't, you know, to me, it was just the tip of an iceberg. So I started creating these new landscapes is what I call them. And thinking about the idea of the fist creating these compositions that really engaged what I was seeing and what I was discussing with, you know, with my daughters, and trying to explain, you know, trying to explain the epidemic or the pandemic of racism, along with being quarantined in a whole nother pandemic. So, you know, of course, I started creating these landscapes, and I created a number of them. And there's always this pedagogical relationship to the drawing. So, you know, referencing, you know, our pedagogical experiences. And I think that the work is really rooted in questioning what role has pedagogy played in creating our current social condition, right? So there's always this reference to pedagogy with the chalkboards. But I wanted to read, there's two books that are really important to my practice. And one of them is Pedagogy of the Oppressed by Paulo Ferrer. And the other one is Ngugi wa Thiong'o's Decolonizing the Mind. But in thinking about pedagogy, I was thinking about these new landscapes and the idea of land, the idea of territory, the idea of collaborating, the idea of memory, and, you know, the idea of place and loss. So there's this paragraph that I share every year. You know, I begin every class with this quote. So it talks about necropolis persons, right? So it says, while life is characterized by growth in a structured, functional manner, the necropolis person loves all that does not grow, all that is mechanical. The necropolis person is driven by the desire to transform the organic into the inorganic, to approach life mechanically as if all living beings were things. Memory rather than experience, having rather than being, is what counts. The necropolis person can relate to a flower or an object or a person only if he possesses it. Hence, a threat to his possession is a threat to himself. If he loses possession, he loses contact with the world. He loves control, and in the act of controlling, he kills life. So I share that for a number of reasons, because, again, this idea of questioning, right? This idea of collaborating with chance, and the idea of questioning our own pedagogical structures, especially in the West, right? Yeah, it just seems to be a more universal question about this idea of protest, or this idea of a landscape, and how can we, you know, in a certain sense, redefine the possibilities of the landscapes by just using this fist, because it's such a, you know, an iconography, you know, image that's been used historically. There's another work that I'm doing right now that involves the intelligence test that they give people who immigrated to this country, right? So to me, there's always this dichotomy of you know, one side of my family being immigrants and the other side of my family being indigenous, right? So there's always this constant friction, this dichotomy that I'm always wrestling with in questioning the idea of epistemology, or the idea of the acquisition of knowledge and what we consider to be knowledge. I just had a solo exhibition recently in Brooklyn. So that's the last thing that I was going to share, if it's still available here.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's only about 1 minute. Am I out of time?
No, go ahead.
If I can find it, hold on a second. Here it is. All right. Am I sharing it? Yeah, here we go. All right, so I'll just share this brief, if it plays. Can you guys see it? You can't see it, right? I don't know if it's gonna work.
No, I actually can't see it.
Yeah, I don't think it's gonna work, but hold on, I'll try one more time. It says it's here, but I don't see it. Yeah, I don't think it's gonna work. So anyway, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nick.
Yeah, thank you, JC. And I actually really appreciate you mentioning Field Guide of Getting Lost by Rebecca Solnit. That's actually one of my favorite books to read. And it actually is a very informative book for anyone who is a visual artist to kind of think about, the possibilities beyond what is like, what is exploring into the unknown. And so the next artist in the exhibition is Mahsa Biglow. Mahsa is a interdisciplinary artist and writer. Her research-based work investigates the intersection of art, mass media, technology, and post-colonialism. She explores these themes in video, installation, performance through storytelling, oral history, and found footage. So I'll hand this over to you, Mahsa.
JC, if you could just stop sharing your screen, though.
Thank you, HC. Hi, everyone. Thank you for being here tonight with us. I'm just going to go ahead and unpack the work that is in the exhibition and show you guys the video that's been showing on top of the installation. For the past 2 years, well, I mean, being an immigrant and away from my whole family, for the past 2 years, I've been constantly attached to my phone and to FaceTime and to other means of communication with my family, which is not healthy, but that has affected my work in a weird way, because I would find myself making monuments for different ideas, and at the end I would look at the work and it looks like a monument, and so is the work that is being shown at the exhibition. So I'm just gonna share my screen. Okay, can you guys see? I hope so. Okay, so the video that is being played on the installation is edited found footage together with this ritual that I have filmed and put together with this found footage videos. But I'm going to take a moment and speak a little bit about these found footage that I'm interested in and I work with. So for the past couple of months, my home country, Iran, has been dealing with a lot of difficulties, which is not a surprise, but this couple of past months, the level of the violence and the protests that has been ending up many people being killed has been has reached to a really next level, even for on the even for the dictatorship of the Islamic Republic of Iran. So I have been, of course, looking at these found footage that people upload with their phones when they're protesting and when the police attacks them. But the moments that hit me the most are the moments that the person who's filming is running away. So the footage is kind of fuzzy, pixelated, just as you see here. And these moments are the true horror moments for me, because this abstraction is even more hideous than the reality that is being going on for more than 40 years now. So I have been putting these footage together with images that I think are complementary to them, because of this feeling of explosion, that feeling of people being fed up, and that moment that it's just enough is enough and they cannot take anymore. I'm not going to go to details of what these exact protests are happening for, or because there are many reasons. If you're interested, I'm sure you can look up and you'll find many, many articles and websites talking about them. And then there's this other part of the video, which is this. So the protests are gonna go on. So there's this other part of the video that two hands are being shown with an egg doing this ritual, which is this this weird, superstitious, of course, ritual that my aunt always would do when someone would get sick. They would take an egg, a raw egg, and they will bring a pencil or Sharpie or something like that, and they would start marking the egg and remembering all the people who that person have been in contact with or have been in touch with. And the ritual is aiming to heal the person and kind of like remove all the bad devil or the devil die from that person so that the sickness will go away. And she would do that for anyone who's sick in any level. It doesn't matter if it's like, God forbid, cancer, or if they just having a cold or flu or something like that. She would bring her actual like eyeliner, and she would like mark the egg, and she would put the egg together with a coin that would later she would give the coin to someone who needs it. And then together with this seeds, we call it esfand, which is, again, they put it on fire for removing bad devil dye. So she would put it together all in plastic or something, and she would smash it, calling the names of those people who the person who have been in contact with. And then the egg would finally crack if it's on the name that of if it's coincidence with the person's name that she's calling, then she would be like, oh, that person has made you sick or something like that. The idea is crazy, but she would do that every single time. And to some level, that egg and that cracking sound, it will bring some level of peace to at least me or to other people who were around her. And she believed in it so much that she would go like, oh yeah, you really need an egg. And she would bring her stuff. So towards the end of the video, I'm putting all these rituals who I really don't believe in, but the sound of that cracking egg and the whole thing about it would bring me some level of peace. And it's as if I'm doing it for for all those people so that the bad devil, so that the devil die would stay away from my country and the people, which is just this ironic, not serious act to a really, really, really serious protest. But I don't know, this is like, this is me doing, making these monuments because at this moment, feeling useless or feeling not being able to do anything is exactly the thing that makes me make these works and make all these monuments. But really at the end of the day, people are getting killed and it's really dark. Sorry for leaving you on that.
But I mean, yeah, that's so true. It's difficult to really, I mean, I think that, you know, I was just thinking about reflecting on JC talking about the sort of epidemic of racism and then also thinking about pandemic. And then thinking about the sort of eruption of protest and how protests become once again, I mean, not that it hasn't been in the past, but once again, it has become front and center in all of our psyches and our minds. And what are, you know, is it okay to, you know, process these horrific events in the ways that we can? Is like, it's a question. And I think that, you know, part of this collaboration with, you know, I forget exactly what JC said, but collaboration with chance, collaboration with chaos, collaboration with things that are out of our control is something that artists are, that's what we're here to do. So thank you so much for your work, Mahsa.
Thank you.
Next we, let's see, who's after? Oh, we have the lovely Hayoon. So Hayoon Lee is an interdisciplinary artist who addresses the sensibilities and susceptibilities of individuals while also encouraging reflection upon human dilemmas. She combines installations, performances, sculptures, videos, and paintings. Lee is constantly rediscovering and reflecting upon the patterns and rhythms which open a window into human desires and actions. The Rice Lab installation is a collection of various types of rice, bones, water, hair, earth, and coins. Rice is a central material in Lee's practice as a signifier of changes in the social spectrum. Food is more than a staple of nourishment. It's life, death, power, empathy, compassion, community, mercy, peace, forgiveness, and love. Let's welcome.
Hi, I think I would like to share my screen, but Mahsa has to believe. Okay. It's always inspiring to see other artists' work. Let me time my 50s. Which that is not more than just sharing artwork. I think it's sharing energy and also positivity. So I would like to share my screen. Ooh, where is it? Okay. Thank you. Let me start from here. This project was done in Gwangju Museum 2019. 2019 during the global crisis, Gwangju city people had the most impact. A lot of people lost their jobs and they are actually lost their businesses. So when I invited to have a show here, I was able to investigate and research their current situation. And my work is often be involved with community be involved because I like the human energy and their ideas and sharing elements of that. When you see this, the dishes and plates, those are actually donated by individual people in Gwangju. Also some business people who lost their businesses, they didn't need all those things. They actually donated to me. And also that wasn't enough for me to settle this one. So my team went out to dumpster diving for weeks to find some other object who has some histories. And on the wall, when you see all those little objects has their own history, that it's almost like human, we have a history, it's something like that. On the wall, there is more than 1,000 burned and unburned rice paper bags donated by local farmers that could not use anymore because of that. They cannot sell the rice anymore. So they were able to give me that, and I was able to make some insulation based on woman's body, eternal mother's body, or as many of you know, South Korea has many, many mountains. We often call that mother. And then during the pandemic, I was working with Jamaica Flux in Queens. It is a very long process. It's a 1 year research-based work I have to do. And often I am drawn to organic materials such as rice, hairs, and bones, and waters, and whatnot. And this project, all these little bones are collected by from me also, but also I collected by a lot of people who donated to me for this project. This project has five different elements. One is research, one is insulation, but also we have interview with five different people, King Manor director and South Queen Women's March director, and the poet from England. She flew all the way to join this project. And also we have a professional nurse who was helping a lot of people during the pandemic. People cannot go out to buy food and whatnot. She was able to go out to help those people. This little rice capsule I was making during the pandemic, I was fasting for a week, 1 meal a day, sometimes 2 meals a day. It wasn't artificial fasting because I think I would like to physically experience how they've gone through. So that was my way of contributing those people who lost their jobs and also people who died during the pandemic. We have a videographer who was following me to Jamaica Center for street performance. What I did, I was able to go outside to meet real people on the street and ask a question about how they deal with their food and how they deal with during the pandemic, how they share their food with people. And as you know, so many domestic violence was happening during that period of time when women could not leave their home because they have no money, no place to go. So South Queen Women's March group was opening food pantry to help them. So to me, bring all those women who has experiences and have a passion and empathy for those people was a very meaningful project. And this one was, is the Elizabeth Foundation has this show, but previously I had this piece at the King Manor Museum to bring those human contact. Number 108 has many different meanings. Of course, many people who understand about Buddhism, they also understand that. But personally, 108 number is interconnecting people together to strengthen their energy and power. And I thought that was very, very important to me at the time. I was walking around the Jamaica Center area because the pandemic, you cannot walk around. But I found tremendous things from local business people, which they lost a lot of business. So I was collecting those data from them and I was able to share with the other things with the Jamaica Center. So my research work is on the Jamaica Center Gallery, but my collaborator was King Manor Museum, which is Lupus King was used to live there 200 years ago. And then the object I used that earlier, those are over 200 years old kitchenware and dining set. It was very fun, but also very, very sad to see a lot of people struggle. I think these bones are really speaks its own language. During the pandemic, there's something happened to me. It's South Korea. There's a natural art biennial. People contact me to donate. Participating their show, because I'm working with natural materials. So I was participating their exhibition. I'm planning to go there next year, perhaps if COVID is okay, to do other outdoor installation, perhaps. In my studio, I am making little pieces that I really found of it. I thought I would like to share all of these. These are all made out of a small little rice paper. Right now, I'm making a large piece to upcoming show coming up, perhaps in 2 years later, maybe this year we are talking about it. So I am trying to make those little things to share with the other people. I don't want to go over 10 minutes, so I'm going to end right here. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Hayoon. HC?
Sorry, I thought I was on. Okay, thank you, Hayoon, so much for delving into what your work is. It's just so beautiful. And just the depth that you kind of explore with rice alone, like, is absolutely mind-blowing, just kind of the narrative that you explore with it. And I don't know if you can see it right now, but this is Hayoon's work behind me. And right next to, like, in conversation with Kosuke, and it's funny because, like, Kosuke pointed out the 108 association with Buddhism with your work, and so there's this beautiful conversation happening in the space right now with it. So we're not quite to Kosuke's work yet, but next we're moving on to Michael Mandiberg. Michael is an interdisciplinary artist whose work manifests the poetics and politics of the information age. This approach crosses media and categories, from large-scale installations to software-driven durational performance to socially engaged collaboration. So today, as part of their presentation, Michael is doing a durational performance that tells the story of digital labor. And in this performance, Mandiberg paints other people while being on a live streaming platform such as Zoom. So Michael, I don't know if you want to make a few, like, say a few words, or if we're just going to watch you paint.
Hi everyone, I'm Michael, and I'm here in my studio at EFA. And on the walls, you can see our some other works. And there's the camera. I have been, when the pandemic started, lots of things happened, but one of the things that happened to a lot of us was getting cut off from other people. I'm immunocompromised, so I had to be especially careful. Everything moved online, and I was just on endless Zoom calls, and I started painting them. I started painting on them, painting them without the people there, in some ways to sort of perform the aloneness of it all, and also to kind of show the kind of interchangeability of the rooms. There's a lot of reasons why, but I mean, I think again, it's sort of like trying to understand what was going on. This was sort of a coping mechanism. Here's a couple of them. I have a couple here. So they're titled based off of the name of the call as it's described on my calendar. So there's one, and then, you know, sometimes they look like that. I've made about 75 of them. And I was painting to begin. At the time, I was working on another project where I've been in portraits. Oh, camera. Come back. Thank you. I was painting portraits of everyone who's worked in my studio. So this is the smallest one. They're sized based off of the number of hours that the person worked. And the largest one so far is about 3 by 4 feet. And in all of this work, it's a lot about, sorry, I kicked the camera and everything moved. Sorry. So I thought I would maybe show briefly a little bit, share my screen and show a little bit about that other work. So that other project is another sort of durational performance where I am recording this work where I'm painting portraits of everyone who's worked in my studio. I'm really trying to represent the work and represent the process of learning. A lot of the people that I work with early on, especially like this person was one of my students. And so they came into my studio as a kind of, in a kind of apprentice mode to learn with me. And so in some ways I am in turn learning while I'm making representations of them, while I am trying to honor their labor. So there's at this point about, you know, almost 800 hours of recording. So sort of the output of this are these paintings. Maybe I'll just pop over here and just show you a couple of them. And so they're all against these digital backgrounds that show the work that they had been doing. And you can see in here that there's a pixelation underneath them. Like I make a print that's from an image underneath them, and then paint on top of it. And I'm particularly trying to show the presence and absence of the hand in order to show the sort of pixelation and the fuzziness, and to some degree it's about memory and the fuzziness of memory and the way in which our memory is dependent on all this sort of digital material. And then when I have lost touch with somebody or I can't get through to them, I paste them, paint them in only in black and white, only in a grisaille as a kind of ghost image. And this doesn't come out totally from nowhere. I mostly have a background. I mean, I come from a kind of conceptual approach where I'm sort of shifting materials and forms to sort of match the work. I've been working with work as a subject for some time. This is a year-long performance I did called Quantified Soul Portrait, where I recorded all of my work, all my labor, my digital labor for a year. On the left, you can see obviously screenshots of my desktop. Every 15 minutes, the center is actual photographs from my webcam, and the right is reflective texts. Taking a screenshot and a photograph every 15 minutes is actually a kind of form of surveillance used for freelance digital labor. So this is, in a sense, a time clock. The structure itself is trying to also reference sort of precedents in terms of this kind of time-based work, like Teaching Say's work. It lasts for a year. The whole thing lasts about 7 minutes. And then it cycles through a couple of times. So I've been engaged in this kind of work about work and durational performance that manifests in other forms for some time. It's kind of one of my main approaches right now. The other component to that project was a film. I don't think you're gonna be able to hear the sound, but I think that's okay. You'll get the picture, which is, I remade Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times using digital labor from the Fiverr platform. So I cut the film up into about 500 clips that range between like 1 second and 20 seconds long, and sent them out onto this platform and asked people to remake them from all over the world. And it's sort of a portrait of the contemporary digital factory. This sort of looks outward to the world, whereas the quantified self portrait sort of looks inward to me as a kind of, I'm not special. I'm not using myself because I'm special. I'm using myself because I'm not special. Like, this is the way that many people's sort of form of labor has taken. So that's what I'm working on. I've got I'm preparing for a show at Denny Dimon Gallery in November of these paintings. I'm not done. I am very anxious about getting everything done. And that's only gonna be the first two chapters of what's gonna be about five chapters of the portraits of my assistants. And with that, I will stop sharing and hand the mic back over.
And Michael, can you reveal what interior are you painting?
Oh, it's Janet Thornhill.
Fantastic. I think Janet recognized it, so.
Yeah.
Great. That's so
I'm having a little trouble with that green. I guess it's also, it's important to note, like, I'm not trained as a painter. I took one class in undergrad, like, so part of this is, learning is a medium for me in some senses.
Right. It's really exciting. I mean, I think taking risks is one of those things that, we forget, like, in some ways it's a labor performance in and of itself. It's like trying to learn something new and acquire a new skill. So thank you so much, Michael. Okay, so we're gonna hear from Kosuke Kawahara, who explores meditative moments of instability and ways to confront fear through his artistic practice. This approach is rooted in the volatile nature of the artist's experience in Japan, specifically multiple major earthquakes, which cultivated an understanding of coexistence with nature. This consequently allows the acceptance of impermanence, imperfection, and insufficiency in process, addressing the wild factors of material aging, deterioration, and discoloration. The series of drawings draw upon Kawahara's improvisational process that compounds textures and images. Ambiguity in the imagery is based on his curiosity around malformed organisms, meditative moments of instability, and the confrontation of fear. Kosuke.
Hi.
I'm gonna spotlight you.
Hi, my name is Kosuke Kawahara. Nice to meet you. And I'd like to share my screen. Firstly, I would like to go over a couple of images of my works and installation in silence, and then I will talk about the idea of my work, and then if I had extra time, I will show some work in progress stuff. So I will guess. So I didn't talk while I show all the images, but it's because the way I presented images is kind of related to the idea of my work. And I want to talk about the title I show at the beginning, Into Ultra Black. This is the name of the project I have been working on since 2012. And the word Ultra Black is the made up a word by myself, and which inspired by the word ultraviolet, which indicates invisible light spectrum. So similarly, I thought profound darkness contains space within, although it does not provide a special characteristic, like you know, it's kind of like a very flat blackness, but there may be some depths, like a dark cave. So experiencing darkness is something like you grow up around the dark caves, or you don't have visual sensitivity, and instead you will touch or feel or listen to what's surrounding you. So there, I was inspired by this concept of the darkness because of a couple of personal experience I had, but this lead me to thinking about something invisible, which is like our past memory, or like things are living in the underground, or also like a micro and the micro, micro and macro world, including presence of the microbe or like viruses or such like. And it's important for me to to sense the part where we never know or understand, because I think we tend to think and use our brain to see or like understand the things. But we also owns our trillions of microbes in our intestine. So we actually live together, and even we say like individual, it's not actually individual. So we are like part of the universe, and we need to listen to something not like verbalized also. So these days we tend to think we tend to feel only fear to those invisible presences because of this, you know, pandemic. But it's also important we appreciate the supporters in our body, like microbes lives in your intestine. Like I a little bit did research, and actually each person owns like 3 or 4 pounds of microbes in your intestine. So you know, it's huge. And my work also relate to the site, the site where I produce those works. And it's because I started to think like probably those land or space or whatever buildings may have a memory of the past, and I don't know, but microbes live there, maybe remember what happened, and if we could talk to them, they will bring up some important narratives. So that's what I want to listen to when I produce my work. And I call it like I call I call this approach intestinal intelligence. So it's usually people call intuitive, but it's more like, you know, not I just think, or I produce drawing or paintings, but we produce and we exist together. That's what I'm thinking of. So I think I'm running out of the time, but what else? Maybe also my work is quite improvisational and also incorporating the material degradation or discoloration, because that's also kind of like unknowable area, and I can't expect fully what comes up, and which is very important to include this process in my work, because it's overlapping with the concept of the darkness.
Beautiful.
Yeah, thank you so much, Kosuke. Yeah, I really like I think it's so interesting how you kind of personify this idea of intuition as if there's this like gut microbiotic, like intestinal, I guess, entity within us, and how that's how we relate and like we kind of think and process through these things. And just like that approach in your practice, I think is kind of interesting to kind of think about how we kind of process our fears, our intuition, and, you know, and just navigate things as a whole. And just like kind of seeing your work in like this type of multiplicity, and like the way that, like, even though they're so small, there's like this intimate space with them, and like they hold so much weight with, like, you know, in series. And so moving on from like this program, we're going to conclude with a Q&A session. And because we did run a bit over time, we have a few minutes left. So if anyone in the audience or even if the artists have questions for each other, feel free to type it in the chat.
Yes, I think that, again, if everyone could just turn on your cameras, if you can. This is also sort of a moment to just say thank you to everybody and also say hi, because normally, you know, we would be able to be in space maybe at this moment and having drinks together, but it's nice to see everyone together at one time. But if you all have questions for each other, I hope that this was sort of like the introduction, but that you'll take the time to actually do studio visits with one another. And then again, if I think most of you are participating in the Armory VIP event that we have going on this weekend. So I hope that you will get a chance to see each other's studios, which will be exciting. Yeah. Any other? And if anybody in the audience wants to send us a question, but I didn't see anything come up. I tried to populate the chat with lots and lots of links and information about each of the artists and additional, like, you know, books and things that were mentioned at the time. So if that was interesting, please copy and paste the chat, because sometimes I feel like it's always one of those things where I realize, oh, I want, what was that book that person mentioned? I really want to make sure I look back at it.
Yeah, and also we've recorded this event, so it will be posted on our website and on our YouTube channel, so you can always refer back to it after.
Yeah, and the other thing is, let's just make it clear that Open Studios is our first public event. Again, COVID protocols are holding up. We're going to see what happens with that, but we will be having a public event for anybody to come to and see, you know, artists in their studios in the live human form. And that's going to be October 20th, 21st. Is it 20th, 21st, and 22nd? Am I getting the dates?
Third week of October.
Yeah, it's October 21st, 22nd, and 23rd. So I'll put that here in the chat. October 21 through 23.
Yep. So if no one has questions, do any of the artists have comments for each other, or do you have any final last words?
What an awesome cohort.
Well, how about thank you? How about thank you to everybody? Thank you all. It was really wonderful. I'm glad that we had this sort of Pecha Kucha style moment to hear from each of you. And it was just very exciting. So I hope everybody comes to see the show. Please register online. And thank you.
Yeah, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, guys. Thank you
thank
so
you.
Much.
Thank you.
Thank you so very much.
Bye. Thank you, guys. Take care.
Okay, HC, you're going to end, or?
Yep, I'll end.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.